We're going to walk through the steps required to get an XNAT set up and running for the first time. Before we begin this video, you might want to have an XNAT of your own up and running in a local environment. If you don't have one and you'd like to get one, the easiest way is to install XNAT in a virtual machine using the Vagrant project. And there's a link to the project in Bitbucket. With that said, let's get started. When you install a brand new XNAT instance, you'll need to configure a few settings before you can begin using this application. In a manual build, before you start Tomcat and run the XNAT application for the first time, there's one configuration you need to set first, telling XNAT how to connect to its Postgres and Hibernate databases. Since this is a Vagrant VM, this step has been done for us already, but it's worth looking at. So I've got an SCP connection here to my local VM opened up, and I'm looking at the XNAT home directory, which by default is at data/XNAT/home. If we look in the config folder, we'll find the XNAT-conf.properties file. This is where the database connections are defined. Unless you're running a plugin that requires something else, these are the only settings that you'll need to specify in a config file for your XNAT. With that said, let's go to our running instance of XNAT in the browser. First, we want to log in using the default credentials admin. This is an account that's set up by default on every XNAT installation, and it's obviously one that you would want to disable or change once you release your XNAT into the wild, or start allowing other users into it. Once you log in, you'll be taken to a setup page. Let's walk through the settings on this page. Your site ID is a simple acronym that serves a dual purpose. It titles your site, and it also becomes the base of every unique ID for subjects and experiments. Your site URL is normally preset in installation and doesn't need to be changed. In this case, we have an aliased URL, xnat-release.xnat-academy.org, that our local hosts file is set to forward to the actual URL of this VM. And then we have an administrative email address, which I'm going to use. Our XNAT Academy address for. We have our data storage locations, and these file paths are relative to your Apache Tomcat server. We can actually see them here in our SCP archive, build, cache, pre-archive, pipeline, etc. Unless your DevOps team has a custom plan for storing your files, it's best to leave these settings as is. Down here we have SMTP server settings. XNAT does not come pre-built with its own SMTP mail server for sending email notifications. Instead, you have to define your own. For a dev instance, I like to use Gmail. The miscellaneous settings are high-level security settings for your site. We'll get a little deeper on these after the setup step. So for require user login, this toggles the guest access on or off. For any system that's still aggregating data, you should require user logins to access your site. If you're launching an XNAT that is meant for public consumption, like XNAT Central, then you would set this to false, and that way the guests would be able to browse the data on your site. Auto-enable user registration. When users register, you can specify whether the site should immediately grant them access or whether their account should be held in a pending state until an administrator enables them. The latter is usually preferred. And then require CSRF token. This should nearly always be set to true, as it prevents cross-site scripting attacks. Let's go ahead and save these changes, and we'll be able to get into the application itself. Super easy. In the next lecture, we'll give you an overview of all the ways you can customize a running XNAT, including the settings that you just defined.